Oz, how many pink signs do you remember seeing?
You can't count them. I mean, they're on any given street, any given lamppost. Actually, when the Pope visited a few years ago, the city painted over all of the crosses painted on the lampposts because they didn't want the femicides to be the subject of the papal visit. And that struck me as a very powerful metaphor for the whole story, really.
That and so much more coming right up on today's episode of The Podspotter. You are listening to The Podspotter. I'm your host, Zach Robidas. There are just too many podcasts out there for you to weed through, and that's why I'm here. I'm going to do the heavy lifting, find the diamonds in the rough, and every week I'll talk to the creators and hosts, and I'll learn about their pod and play clips and chat with them, and hopefully you find it useful. And if you do, subscribe to our pod and visit thepodspotter.com and on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at The Podspotter for extra content and info on what's coming up. Then, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. It's really a pleasure. I've been screening hundreds of podcasts. Before we start the podcast we feature today, just want to let listeners know it contains accounts some listeners might find disturbing, but without them, this story can't fully be understood. Please take care while listening. Stanstead, Quebec and Derby Line, Vermont are adjoining small towns along the U.S.-Canadian border, where over the past 25 years, hundreds of women have gone missing. Of the bodies found, strange symbols have been carved into their skin. Some have had their wrists bound with shoelaces. Multiple mass graves have been excavated during that time, yet convictions remain minimal and justice for the victims' families is non-existent. 95% of all femicides go without conviction. Got your attention? Why is this topic not on the front page of every newspaper in America? Well, one reason might be because they have nothing to do with our neighbors to the north in Stanstead, Quebec, or Derby, wherever, Vermont, no. These atrocities take place every day in a town whose name you know, but as soon as I say it, the cliches and preconceived notions of an entire population of people will cloud your judgment of the facts surrounding femicides in, wait for it, Juarez, Mexico. Did you feel it? That numb, desensitized wave of apathy? But hosts Mónica, Ortiz, Uribe, and Oz Woloshyn are used to your complacency. It is, in fact, a major theme of their recently released podcast, Forgotten, Women of Juarez, a 10-part deep dive into decades of kidnappings, killings, and cover-ups of young Mexican women near the border that separates Juarez, Mexico, and El Paso, Texas. Joining me to discuss 10 episodes of extraordinarily thorough research into the terrified witnesses, corrupt authorities, and complicit consumers that have helped perpetrate these crimes is both Mónica and Oz. Thank you for being here. Thank you for sharing your wonderful podcast with us. How are you?
Hi, Zach. Thanks for featuring us.
Yes, good. Thank you. Thanks for the interesting, defamiliarized introduction. I wasn't sure where you were going with that.
So both of your eyes light up. It was wonderful. Oz, why don't we start with an introduction from you, maybe a little bit about your background outside of the pod?
My background is actually as a TV producer and documentary filmmaker of sorts. And I was very drawn to the U.S.-Mexico border as a immigrant to the U.S. myself and as the grandson of a refugee from Ukraine to Britain after the Second World War. And just always wanted to go to El Paso and always wanted to understand a bit more about the U.S.-Mexico border. And I actually went down there from New York for the first time when I was working on a documentary about Border Patrol and Hispanic Border Patrol agents and the psychological consequences of having to enforce the law, you know, against people who come from the same community in many cases. And while I was there, somebody I was working with in the documentary who comes from El Paso but has a lot of family in Mexico told me about this series of horrific murders that have been going on since the 90s, right across the border in a place in Juarez where you could see standing in El Paso. And I just was very drawn to learning more about this story, which so perfectly encapsulated the relationship between borders and fate. And so I started looking for a partner and was introduced to Mónica and had a hard job persuading her to partner up with me. But that was the beginning of our story, I guess, 2 years ago, if not more, 2.5 years ago.
And Mónica, how do you introduce yourself outside of the pod?
Well, I'm a native of the U.S.-Mexico border, my entire life is about straddling two cultures, two languages, two countries. I'm surrounded by borders, not only national borders, but state borders. I live in El Paso. So I'm born and raised here. I'm bilingual. I pursued a career in journalism, primarily in radio. So very few national outlets have a reporter stationed here in El Paso on the border, even though this is a huge news generator location. So that presented an opportunity for me. And when a major drug war broke out in my backyard in Ciudad Juarez, beginning in around 2008, you know, all the male national correspondents were based in Mexico City, and it was four women who were based in El Paso who were the ones who would cross over into Juarez and cover what was happening there, you know, for TV, for print, for radio, for the AP. And yeah, it was the four of us that we, you know, kept an eye on each other and looked out for each other. And I've been covering the border ever since.
It seems to be a major theme of your podcast that it takes strong women. That's not the first time we'll hear that. The men sort of disappear in the story a little bit. But the relationship that, you know, the relationship between you two is the sort of stuff of every like 80s and 90s buddy cop movie here in America, this sort of like seemingly opposite people aligned for a common purpose. And I guess, Mónica, I'm curious how an outsider like Oz helps you tell this story. And I guess, and Oz, how you knew that you needed someone like Mónica to help you tell it.
Well, as Oz has already stated, and as we discuss in the podcast, there was a lot of reluctance on my part to partner with a dude who I didn't know, who had a funny accent, and was coming over here and asking me to tell this very, very painful and tragic and sensitive story. So yes, there was some reluctance on my part. I'd worked with outsiders before and gotten burned on this very trying to tell this very story.
In what way? In that they're unable to follow through with it. They get scared, or it's just too many. It's too big.
You know, there was some reluctance on the part of our sources, and that in part caused the project to collapse. I told Oz, okay, we'll take it 2 weeks at a time, and I'll feel you all out and see how it works. Yeah, it's here we are 2.5 years in. And I think the reason for me why this relationship works so well is because the outsider-insider combination is the perfect combination to examine just about anything. I like to call Oz the satellite and and myself the microscope. I come in and take a very close, intimate look into things. And it's a lot more difficult for me to zoom out and see the big picture. And that's usually where Oz comes in.
Well, you know, as soon as I became interested in telling the story, I realized that not only, you know, could I not tell the story, begin to tell the story alone, but that also there was a kind of history of exploitation in this story. I mean, Mónica mentioned some of the sources. I mean, there's been a constant struggle between the mothers of the victims, you know, on the one hand, often feeling like they're pleased to be represented or advocated for by people who come in from the outside, but at other times questioning the motivations of those people coming in from the outside. And the story is really at its heart about what happens when, you know, one group of people profits from another group of people who they view as being less valuable. And so, you know, it's very important to structure the podcast around Monica's experience and 15 years of reporting the story, but a lifetime living on the border. And how many times, we probably spoke 10 times even before you agreed to the first 2-week period.
It could have been. I'm not sure, but I'm sure I wrote very short, terse emails in the beginning.
And then right before I was due for my first trip, Monica wrote, just FYI, the drug war was really kicking off. A senior police officer just had to seek asylum in the US. It's a very dangerous moment to come to Juarez. You know, are you sure you want to do this? And I wasn't sure if it was a warning or a test or both, but we probably both.
If you've ever been to Juarez, disposing of bodies is real easy. You don't have to dig through hard dirt. You're digging through sand.
Just across the bridge from El Paso, Texas, hundreds of young women have been turning up dead in Juarez, Mexico. Many are discovered in mass graves. Some have strange symbols carved on their bodies. Some have their hands bound with shoelaces. And everyone, from the families of the victims to the United States FBI, has tried to uncover who is behind these crimes. But one thing is clear. The crimes are connected.
They were not just random victims. The women were picked. They were selected.
I mean, there could be an abduction in broad daylight. No one saw it. No one talked about it. These were like ghosts.
The numbers started to rise, and then a lot of theories were floated up. The gangs, the serial murder, the cartels, organ traffickers, the possibility of some sort of strange devil worship.
I'm wondering, either of you listen to The Daily on Wednesday? It's the New York Times podcast. They featured a story about Miriam Rodriguez and another abduction story, this one from San Fernando, Mexico. And in it, we learn how the abduction of young women is evolving. You kind of touch on this on your pod, where it was specifically for pleasure, not specifically, but primarily pleasure early on, but it is evolving to more financial and more kidnapping, extortion.
When women are being abducted, you know, and raped and murdered for pleasure and for collateral in bonding rituals in organized crime, why not abduct them to sell them into sex slavery? If it's something which is done for, in any case, for pleasure, why, if there was a profit motive, would you not do that if you organized crime? And so I think, you know, Monica described in the course of our reporting several waves of femicide, and the third wave, which Monica, you reported on the most, was most obviously connected to human trafficking. And there were some just absolutely brutal stories of mothers searching around town for their daughters and people knowing exactly where those daughters were, and those daughters still being alive and nobody telling the mothers where they were because either they were being paid for their silence or they were too scared to speak.
No, I mean, these women are treated like, hold on, there's a helicopter overhead, which is part of the everyday life of living on the border. It's highly militarized, and I've got helicopters flying over my home every day, all day. There it is. But where was I? What were we talking about? Oh, yes. So these women themselves become commodities almost. They become something to consume. I mean, another thing, and I'll read another quote from Chuck Bowden's While You Were Sleeping article, which just always it gives me chills. We talk about, you know, sometimes the companies who have factories in Juarez, they say, well, life is cheaper in Juarez. The cost of living is a lot less expensive, so it's okay if we pay them a lot less. And what Chuck Bowden has to say about that is, basically, the only cheap thing in Mexico is flesh. Human bodies you can fornicate with or you can work to death.
Mónica, this podcast is very rich with characters, heroes, villains, some in between. But I think that the character of Juarez itself is critical to people's understanding of your story. And I'm wondering if you could just give some bullet points about the setting of your podcast.
I can stand at my at the edge of my university and look out into the backyards of people who live in Juarez, into the communities where some of these women went missing. And it's very, very striking, particularly if you've never been here before, just to see this collision of a highly developed, wealthy nation next to a nation that is still developing, that is still struggling, where a factory worker will make $10 in a day, not an hour, in a day, $10. And so you are face to face with this stark inequality. We're also sister cities in that we have these tremendous connections to each other, to either side, whether it's family, business, school, people are crossing all the time.
It sounds, you know, from your visit, from the audio and from how you explain it, that it's terribly vibrant and alive and active, and it creates just the sort of perfect setting for people to take advantage of newcomers. Is it, Oz, you're from New York, is there a place like it in and around New York that you would liken it to?
Definitely not. Walking into Juarez, it's almost, it really is walking into a different world. And, you know, you have the bridge gives onto Avenida Benito Juarez, which is kind of the main drag, which actually used to be a big destination for US tourists. And there's a bar called the Kentucky Club, which is one of the claimants to having invented the margarita cocktail. And it's called the Kentucky Club because actually Juarez has a history in the prohibition of being a whiskey distilling and smuggling capital. But then as you go kind of into the downtown of Juarez, where many of the women were last seen alive, there's this density and you know, the streets are so narrow, and there's market stalls, and there's buses and exhaust fumes and food cooking, and it's kind of exciting, but there's also this profound sense that there are eyes on you and that you could easily disappear into the crowd. Even as, you know, outside journalists, there's a sense of disquiet. And it really struck me thinking to go there as a newcomer, as a woman from somewhere else in rural Mexico, it would be a very scary place, I think.
At first, the authorities tried to claim the murders were random and individual. But then, in 1995, the first mass grave was discovered in a place called Lote Bravo. 9 women's bodies were discovered in this deserted plot of land, not far from the airport. The bodies were strewn around as if the killer hadn't even made an effort to hide them. Some of the victims had their hands tied with shoelaces. Others had a severed left breast. One had a triangle carved on her back. Who could be capable of this? Speculations ran from a satanic cult to a serial killer. Then, in 1996, another mass grave was discovered. And then another, and another, and another. The most recent was in 2012.
Your pod focuses on 3 mass graves that are found in a span of time from 95 to 2012. But this is currently, they're still finding, I mean, this is not a past problem. This podcast isn't about just history. It's current and it's ongoing, correct?
Well, in Mexico, unfortunately, there has always been a history of mass graves, and more recently, and many, if not all of them, are tied to the drug war, which originally was most prominent along the border, and now has spread countrywide. The more recent mass graves that are turning up, the victims that are discovered, some of them are migrants, Central Americans who are making the journey from places like Guatemala and Honduras, coming north. And sometimes they're picked up also for exploitation, for ransom. But in many cases, you have some, I mean, certainly in the cases that we looked at, there is tons of evidence of complicity of the authorities with the criminals. And so if you have that, obviously that's going to make it very difficult to solve these kinds of crimes.
Is there no official log of victims? Is there no true number, true account?
There are some records, but nothing that's entirely comprehensive. One of the most disturbing things revisiting these murders is looking at just how many unidentified victims there are. A colleague and mentor of mine, Diana Washington Valdez, the El Paso Times reporter, who we feature in the podcast, she's written the book on the subject. And one of the appendixes of the book are a list of the victims she was able to identify during her reporting. And again, on that list, there's many of desconocidas or unknown women.
When you asked about the official record, one of the problems is, for example, there was a case of a man in Ruidoso, New Mexico, who murdered his girlfriend and then drove her across the border into Juarez and dumped the body, hoping that it would get lost in the mix. And as it happens, he was apprehended and that didn't happen. But it just goes to show that when you have so many unsolved crimes against women in the same place, that it can become a magnet for other bad actors and other bad behavior. So I think one of the questions people have had for us, I mean, it's now a few months into the end of production, and a few people have said to me, well, why did you never give the definitive number of the number of victims of these crimes? And the answer is because that's impossible.
Yeah, no, it doesn't exist. And that's part of the tragedy of this story.
I think what you do better than just giving definitive numbers, you make it personal by focusing on the individual victims, specifically with Sagrario Gonzalez Flores. Monica, we often talk on this pod about the sort of cost of storytelling. I don't take it for granted, you know, that you're here sharing these events and that when you have to relive the trauma of the place that you've called home and you know, care deeply about, that it does cost you something. And so I don't take it lightly that I'm, you know, just throwing this audio at you and asking you these questions. Yes. But I do want to play when Oz, early on asks you this question about Sagrario, and just to hear the weight in your voice as you once again have to talk about her and her life.
Who is she?
So, she sang in the church choir and taught Sunday school to kindergartners. She has a boyfriend. His name is Andres. She's got a notebook where she writes poetry. She puts all kinds of stickers in this notebook, like hearts and princesses and rabbits. And her handwriting is impeccable, written in block print, very neat. And it's clear she's sweet on Andres, too. She's got his name and phone number written on the front cover.
And what was it like looking into that book?
Oh, gosh, how do you describe that? This is like a relic of someone who's gone. It's the closest thing to her. I mean, it's so precious just to see her name on there, her own name written in her own handwriting. I don't have the words for it. I don't have the words for it. But she's the whole reason why I'm sticking around to tell the story.
Why do you keep telling the story to gringos like Oz? And where do you find the resolve? And why do you do it?
Why do you keep telling the story? Because these women, these women matter. These women are human beings. They were somebody's loved one. They were beautiful human beings, and they had their humanity stolen from them in the most horrific way imaginable. Those of us who are in safer, more comfortable places bear some responsibility for their deaths. Another reason that I want to keep telling this story is because it's not just Juarez. Violence against women exists everywhere. And it's existed since the beginning of time. And I'm just, you know, I was rereading Ovid's Metamorphoses and seeing that these are all stories of violence against women and rape. And I see Juarez in this story that was told how long ago? 1,000 years ago or so, however long ago it was. I tell this story because it keeps happening. Yeah. I don't think it's ever going to go away. And so as long as it doesn't go away, we have to keep denouncing it.
Just telling the story, you endure emotional trauma, but also you have the omnipresent fear of physical trauma, which you explained to Oz in this clip.
I would think carefully about what I would wear going to Juarez. I really loved this pair of cowboy boots that I had, and I would love wearing them. And they would be helpful, like if you're out reporting in the desert, they're helpful to keep the sand out. But I would think twice about putting those cowboy boots on because I would think, shoot, what if someone stuck me into the back of their trunk? It would be very uncomfortable to be wearing these cowboy boots stuffed in somebody's trunk.
It's my extreme privilege to just come to my little desk here and podcast without fear of kidnapping. I can't imagine the weight of trauma from having to just think about that. Like you just get used to thinking, oh, I got to plan my wardrobe around potential kidnapping.
When you're starting out and when you haven't reported anywhere else, but a place where there's a rampant drug war going on, you just kind of... You almost accept these things and say, well, this is just what I got to do to do my job. It's not until you step back later on and you realize, no, wait, this is not normal. This is not good. That you're like, what was I doing?
You are tied to this place. You see yourself in the victims. Oz, you chose this. What like, was there ever a point where you were like, I'm putting my family, I'm putting my loved ones in danger if I continue down this path?
Well, I certainly don't have such steely nerves as Monica, that's for sure. And our first trip to downtown Juarez, which I only realized afterwards was one of the most dangerous parts. Well, I realized what once we arrived, but we didn't.
Did you wear that sweater?
I didn't wear this sweater. But I mean, you know, you can wear whatever you like. But me and Julian, who was the producer, both you know, blonde, very pale, blue eyes. So no matter what we wore, I think we blew Monica's cover suddenly walking around downtown Juarez. And no, I mean, it's just after we were sort of threatened in downtown Juarez, we were driving to the next place and there was a hailstorm and I jumped out of my skin, you know, and I realized that sense of being like always on edge is really, like, to Monica's point, like we're not used to that in the US, and like it puts you in a different frame of mind, and I think it's probably emotionally limiting as well. I mean, to be constantly in fear, in fact, I don't think it is, I know it is, and so that's really, really tough. I mean, but
never an in over my head moment. Never a
more than the fear. It was the sadness that caught me by surprise. Honestly, you know, you're right. I am an outsider, and like, it's not my story by any means. And yet, you know, especially when Monica went back to interview Sugario's mother the final time, when we were actually towards the end of the podcast, and she shared the whole family story of what happened afterwards, and you know, she became this amazing advocate and testified in Mexico City, and I think in Washington, D.C., and it's an amazing leader in the community, but she paid an incredible price. And it's in order to tell the story, you have to separate it from it. You have to alienate yourself from it, because otherwise you can't think, well, where's the cliffhanger? Where's the suspense? Why is the audience going to care? But when you suddenly, when the podcast finished and suddenly you relax and you no longer have to think in functional terms about how to make this as compelling as possible, I was overwhelmed by grief, honestly.
Zach, there's a fantastic article that was written almost now going to be, I guess, 20, 25 years ago that I recommended to the crew when we got started on this project. It was written by a journalist named Chuck Bowden, who has since passed. And he wrote it. It's an essay he wrote for Harper's Magazine called While You Were Sleeping. And he went around and shadowed the crime photographers at the local papers, and they'd go from murder to murder, crime scene to crime scene, photographing the site, and so, you know, he was able to predict that this is the direction that we're heading. Juarez is the ugly truth that none of us want to acknowledge or confront is happening in Juarez. I'll read you a quote from that one article. This future is based on the rich getting richer, the poor getting poorer, and industrial growth producing poverty faster than it distributes wealth. He saw that in Juarez in 1996. And like I say, you can stand on the U.S.-Mexico border in El Paso and Juarez and see it with your own eyes.
Well, one way that activists have chosen to shine the spotlight on those, on the victims and on the moments of inequality are the black crosses, which you use for your cover art of your podcast. And I just want to play a clip from that field trip downtown to Juarez, where you sort of reveal why that is chosen for your cover art.
So it doesn't take long before we come across these missing posters. The flyer for a missing woman. She looked maybe between 14 and 16 years old.
The black and white flyers bearing pictures of young women's faces are not the only evidence of what happened here. Also on lampposts are pink squares with black crosses overlaid. Each one has been painted by a family grieving a lost daughter.
Well, it used to be that every time the body of a murdered woman was discovered in Juarez, the families of previous victims and activists would come out and paint these crosses as a reminder to the city that these murders were happening.
Oz, how many pink signs do you remember seeing on your field trip to Juarez?
I mean, you can't count them. I mean, they're on any given street, any given lamppost will have one. And actually, when the Pope visited a few years ago, the city painted over all of the crosses painted on the lampposts because they didn't want the femicides to be the subject of the papal visit. And that struck me as a very powerful metaphor for the whole story, really. And there was an amazing scene as well where Paola Flores was painting a cross outside the prison, and a policeman came up to her and said, you know, what are you doing? You can't paint here. And she just said to him, have you lost a daughter? And he let her carry on.
Well, with your permission, we have one here. We got our hands on one. I'd like to add it to the pod wall behind me. Forgotten Women of Juarez.
Yeah.
The pink sign. Mm-hmm. That that activists continue to, they maintain those, right? And that's all just grassroots.
Well, last year was the first year that that Paola Flores did not go out in the middle of April to retouch these crosses around the city. It had become a tradition every year. The day her daughter disappeared, she would go out and retouch the crosses with other activists, with family members. And again, because of the pandemic, last year was the first year that they didn't do it.
Guys, we hear about femicide and often see murders depicted in film and television as these horrible symptoms of cartels' abuse of power. But your podcast provides an alternate point of view to these murders by revealing how they are not a side effect of impunity, but rather a tool to strengthen trust among networks. And I want to play a bit from your interview with Candace Skropik, the forensic criminologist, who helps articulate that point, because I'd never thought of it in these terms before.
The men that I study, mostly they operate alone. I mean, think about it. If I were intent upon killing a number of people as long as I could, I don't think I'd want anybody watching me do it. Certainly they could turn me in. How would I know I could trust them with this? So I started thinking, how could all of these men trust each other? What if one of them goes to the bar and starts shooting his mouth off about their latest victim? And then I realized he's not going to be doing that. Because there is a pact. If it's not spoken, it's certainly unspoken. That if you start turning any of us in, pointing any fingers at any of us, we think you love your family and we'll kill them first.
This is clearly a big aha moment for you in the pod.
This is a forensic criminologist who spent her whole career studying serial killers and horrific crimes. And, you know, in this interview, you could hear the rawness in her voice and the wonder and the horror all these years later about what's happening. And I just think that's worth pointing out. I mean, it was the experience of doing these interviews. It was traumatizing and re-traumatizing, and I've never, you know, I interviewed a lot of people in my time, but the depth and clarity of emotion for people who have touched this story that persists for so many years is quite something. You know, as to the group killings, I mean, I did find it absolutely fascinating because we think a lot about hazing rituals in, you know, in the army or in boarding schools, whatever it may be.
Frats.
You know, there was a documentary that came out last year, which called The Vow on HBO about Nixium, and this idea that the women who joined the cult had to give collateral about themselves. And so these women served as collateral. And, you know, the point of these cartels, they're businesses. They exist to make money. These women were being killed to cement bonds, to make business run better. I mean, it was such a powerful moment of realization of, you see the seeds of this type of thing or this type of behavior or perverse and extreme extension of how that kind of thinking can manifest in a place where there's no law.
But it can't be all put on the cartels. You repeat quite a bit in your pod the quote from the author of Midnight in Mexico: when you don't want a crime to be solved, the resolution will be embarrassing or the crime will come back to you. Would either of you be willing to talk about the sort of complicit role of local police that local police played in the kidnapping of women like Sagrario and Alejandra?
I believe that quote that you read, Zach, came from an FBI agent who worked in Juarez and investigated a mass grave that included U.S. citizens in the back of a stash house in Juarez. So yes, I mean, if you are a drug trafficker and you have this very lucrative business that is illicit and you have to move it transnationally, and you have tons of money to play with, then yeah, you're going to use some of that money to buy in influence and access and permission. And so part of that is bribing police officers and politicians and sometimes even journalists. It's simply like, I think on their end, it's a business expense.
In Matito, we start to get a clear picture of who the real villains are, though, of your podcast. Spoiler alert, it's American consumers.
The maquila industry is the backbone of the Juarez economy. And trade between the U.S. and Mexico generates more than $500 billion every year. Millions of jobs in the U.S. are tied to trade. And in Juarez, you'll find companies like Boeing, like Dell, General Electric, Johnson & Johnson, manufacturing things. There's probably something you use in your everyday life that was made in Juarez, whether it's the seat cover in your Ford or maybe your Mercedes-Benz, the inside of your washing machine, your laptop computer, or your dog's chew toy. It doesn't matter if you live hundreds of miles away. You touch something that came from Juarez every day.
That's it. Metido. Did we explain? Did I explain?
Well, metido is typically, metido means like the one of the translation is involved, or you're in on something. And it's typically reserved for people who are in on the drug trade. But among the many conversations between our production team, we realized that metido also can apply to someone like me or like Oz, this is a story that sucks you in and you become metido, involved in that way. That once you know this story, it's hard, if not impossible, to let it go. But maybe you can ignore it. You can never forget it, but you can ignore it. And that's the problem. That's why we want to keep talking about it, because we don't want you to ignore what's happening to Juarez. We don't want you to ignore Juarez and
like
what happens there.
I like flipping it on its head and using it as a positive, because in your pod, I was thinking of it, you know, with the Chadwick Crawford story of it's a way to implicate people and to erase them from the story by using bribe money. But it's also in a way to sort of engender people and bring them in and get them on the right side here. I think that this is one of the most important takeaways from your pod, is just understanding everyone's role, our own role in this. I'm wondering if either of you can help clarify. You talk about the line a lot, this linear line between victim and consumers. And if one of you could maybe just clarify the dots on that line to spell out exactly how we all are sort of complicit.
A huge part of what's fueling the violence in Juarez, and that violence includes these murders of women, has to do with consumption habits of Mexico's northern neighbor. And this is both legal consumption and illegal consumption are the two main sources. Illegal consumption being narcotics, right? We are the biggest consumers of illegal narcotics in the world. The market is right there. We're writing the checks for these drug traffickers. The legal consumption is one that maybe isn't thought of as much. And this is where we talk about the maquiladoras. A maquiladora is a factory that makes the components of larger things, a car, a computer, a washing machine. And so companies like the ones I mentioned will have a factory in Juarez, pay their floor workers $10 a day to put these components together to make the full thing. And these workers, they on that kind of salary, they can't afford to live in a safe neighborhood. They can't afford to even keep their refrigerator fully stocked. They can't afford to defend themselves when a horrific crime happens to them or their family, when they face injustice. And so you've got this pool of cheap, exploitable labor that's allowing for a booming business. And so these kids see, well, we can't even afford a pair of tennis shoes. The narcos know this. They come by and they recruit in these neighborhoods. And so then you have another pool of recruitable foot soldiers for the cartel. It's a vicious cycle. And again, it comes back to our consumption habits, both legal and illegal.
Guys, we're going to take a quick break. More from Oz and Monica when we come back. I am here to fill the role of looking for great content for you. I got this, okay? But if you have a show that you think I need to know about, please let me know via thepodspotter.com or Facebook or Twitter or Instagram at thepodspotter. Thank you. With the upcoming release of the Danish, Spanish, and German versions of the pod, what are your hopes for new audiences hearing this story for the very first time? And what can the average podcast listener do right now that is disgusted and outraged by hearing the story?
One of the first things I told Oz when we started working on this project is, do you think that we can also do a version of this podcast in Spanish? And the reason being that, again, many people have come to tell this story, and often it is outsiders who are telling the story in a different language. And so the families that tell their stories at great personal pain, they don't get to really hear the final product. And so I thought it was very important that we be able to provide the series so that they could listen and judge our work for themselves.
Has Paula, the mother of Sugrario, who you feature, has she listened? And I'm wondering what her response was.
She has a granddaughter who does speak English, and I spoke with her. I had a conversation with her, and hold on, I've got a. Now ambulance is going by. Also a daily occurrence. Okay, I'll start over.
We're keeping it in.
So Paula doesn't speak English, so she is unable to understand the series. Her granddaughter, on the other hand, does speak English, and she took a listen to the series, and I guess, you know, what struck me the most was that she said she learned things about her. Sorry, let me wait a few seconds. Okay. So Paula's granddaughter does speak English, and she was able to listen to portions of the podcast. And one of the things that I guess made me feel all right was that she said she learned things about her aunt Sagrario, whom of course she never met, that she didn't know. So she was learning things about her own family through the podcast.
Yeah.
We're coordinating the release for International Women's Day in March, and the hosts of the Spanish version are, one is called Rosana Fuentes Berain. Is that right, Mónica? Did I pronounce it right-ish?
Berain, I'm not sure.
And Sandra Romandía. And Rosana was one of the original editors who worked on this story when it first started reaching the national consciousness in Mexico in the mid-90s. And she edited one of the journalists who covered it alongside Diana Washington Valdez. And so the premise of the Spanish version of the podcast is Rosana going back to Juarez as this place where the women's protest movement against violence against women was really fostered. And now you have these coordinated protests all over the world, from Mexico City to Paris to Berlin to London. But Juarez's role in this as a crucible of activism is kind of been forgotten. And so part of Rosana's adaptation is to say, like, what's going on in this place, Juarez, where this story began, and how can we bring people's attention back to it? Likewise, the German version is being hosted by two journalists, one of whom is German Yazidi and the other is German Turkish. And one of the reporters has done work on femicide in Syria and ISIS's crimes against women, and the other has done work on violence against women and murder of women in migrant populations in Germany. The Danish version is being hosted by a female reporter who's done a lot of work on misogyny in politics in Denmark. And so what's interesting about the adaptations is the story is obviously universal. It's very, very particular. It's very located in Juarez. To Monica's earlier point about the microscope and the satellite, but wherever you are, this will touch you.
I ask all of our podcast hosts this question about maybe a piece of audio to induct into the inevitable podcast Hall of Fame from your podcast. When that is built, as attendees of the Podcast Hall of Fame approach the Forgotten Women of Juarez kiosk and they hit the little red button. Maybe Oz first, do you have a sound bite or anything, maybe the theme song, something that you'd hope to play?
Well, you know, from the beginning on this production, our producer and lead sound engineer was Julian Weller, who had a masterful sense of how this show should sound. And I think his masterpiece in the show was Paula's dream. She dreams after her daughter is killed about being visited by her daughter, and the daughter Sagrario comes and Paula can't see her face, and she says, you know, daughter, I understand I'm not worthy of seeing your face anymore, but please tell me who killed you. And Sagrario in the dream tells Paola, and indeed the name she gives corresponds to somebody who later was implicated in the crime. And, you know, the tone of our conversation has been very analytical, but the feel of the podcast is very much like a story, and there are dream sequences, and there are moments where you do get lost in the audio environment, lost in it in a good way, we hope. But I think it's interesting working with a team on these products, and how, you know, you're often surprised by the extent of your collaborators' talents, and really, I think that little 2 or 3 minute sequence would be my pick for the Audio Hall of Fame, along with the theme tune, which I think is incredible. Mónica picked that out, and we got so blessed by Natalia Laforcade, the artist who sang it, basically putting in a good word on our behalf to be able to license it. But yeah, that's, I love the theme tune as well.
One of the pieces of sound that immediately came to mind, which you know, like this series is a grim one, is just how listening to Paola's story and then revisiting an interview I did back in 2008 or 2009 with another mother whose daughter was kidnapped and killed in what you could describe as the third wave of femicide, which I reported on. And hearing just the echoes, it was like I was hearing the echoes between these two mothers. And to revisit that tape 10 years later for this series was very, very, very chilling. And that moment in the 10th episode where we hear from Susana Montes, the mother who I interviewed 10 years ago, following her in downtown, handing out flyers, and then hearing Paola's story. The echoes between those two mothers, it's tragic and it's infuriating because it's the same thing again.
Susana said, they told me she's probably being sold, that there's an organized group downtown that's taking them. It's not just my daughter, Susana told me. It's more girls are missing. A friend who worked at a fabric store downtown reported seeing Lupita cradling a pair of new tennis shoes in her arms. He said he last saw Lupita rushing down Mina Street.
Oz, one final question, just about just the scope of, you know, your reporting. What does this story look like in the sort of movie of the investigative journalism where like the wall has all the pictures and the strings connecting the thing and the victim and the timeline? Like what does all this look like? Sorry to ask these analytical questions, but I'm interested with a story of this size, how you keep it all contained.
I mean, teamwork is the dream work, I think. Yeah. I remember, you know, Mónica is a reporter's reporter, and we had so many interviews and hours of tape. I remember we had one particular session in a room in New York where we were all feeling utterly defeated emotionally in probably December 2019, thinking, okay, well, we've got to pull this all together now. What are we going to do? And we sat there with a whiteboard and we wrote the name of the 10 main characters, and we plotted out their arc about what happened to them. And that's really where we came up with this Metido theme, because one of the extraordinary things is that in almost every character's arc, everyone who touches this gets chewed up and spat out and broken and often even killed by it, from, as you said, journalists to lawyers to activists. But there are some who don't. And, you know, I think a big part of this was honestly Paola's rise to from a migrant to Juarez to a community leader who had the school that a local school made and named after Sagrario, so her dead daughter's name is on the graduating diploma of all of the kindergartners. But also Monica, I mean, you will speak about this better than I do, but there was some sense of this project representing some threads coming together, I think.
When you work for just about any news outlet, it's always like you're sprinting toward the next story, and you never have time to step back and take stock of it all. And so when you've been doing it for 10 plus years, I mean, that's a lot of time to step back and evaluate. That's exactly what this project allowed me to do. Because we're looking at, as reporters, we're asking the deeper questions and looking at the challenges and the promise and the problems. And so to be able to step back, I was able to, this series allowed me to reflect on a decade of reporting on the border and how it was all interrelated, particularly to the murders of these women.
Hard to imagine anyone not still listening, but I stand on tradition. It's the last 5 minutes of our podcast, which means no one is here. No one is listening. They're off doing other things. The car ride is over and they're done cooking. And so it's just us, Monica and Oz, and we can use this last 5 minutes to talk about whatever you'd like, whatever you'd like to get off your chest. You can tell them off a former lover, hum a tune, recite more quotes, whatever you'd like. I'll go first. And I thought I'd share about my visit to Rosarito, the maybe one of the two times I've been to Mexico. Entered the border there by San Diego and Tijuana and went south. And I remember just being struck by, we were hanging out like smoking, or some people were outside at one point smoking, and just the tanks coming down the street, the amount of like the and how weak that looks when you have to like flex with giant tanks to parade down the street to show strength. Like, I don't know. I was just struck by the everyday of that. Must be crazy.
Well, I guess I'll go next. I mean, it's through this process, I thought more and more about my grandparents, in particular, my grandfather's refugee story. He was a Ukrainian prisoner of war in 1939, spent most of the war in German camps, and then most Soviet prisoners of war were sent back to the Soviet Union under the terms of the Treaty of Yalta, and Stalin treated them all as deserters, so they were then sent straight from the German camps to Siberia, where most of them died, or many of them died. And my grandfather, I think because he'd gone to Germany age 13, had picked up good enough German that he was basically able to disappear and not be deported back to the Soviet Union. And so he came to Britain in the early 50s and lived in a refugee camp outside of Bicester near Oxford, where his son then amazingly went to university, my father. The reason the British in the end were accepting those refugees, I mean, part of it may have been because they felt like it was the right thing to do, but part of it was because it was a time when they wanted the labor. It was also the same time when all of the Caribbean population were allowed to come to the UK, or encouraged to come to the UK to build the highways and all that kind of stuff. And so, you know, this link between labor, migration, exploitation, it's nothing new. And I think we should be very conscious of the fact that, it's not, the struggle is not over.
I wanted to close with a book that I turned to very soon after we had finished the podcast. I mentioned earlier that I had reread Ovid's Metamorphoses. There's an author, her name is Nina McLaughlin, who also studied the classics, and I think one day she was out for a walk, and she's started hearing the stories that Ovid tells from the point of view of the women. And so she came up with this book called Wake Siren, Ovid Resung. But one of the stories that Nina retells in her books is the story of the sirens, right? These are supposed to be women who, with their song, they lure in men, and then who then meet their death, right? And so they're supposed to be these this terrible thing. Hmm. But they're singing a song. And so she retells their song, their story in their words. And I'm going to read just a little bit of that because I found some strength in it. So she says, "We're golden feathered bird girls. We sing because we always sing. And oh, sister, do the men get lost? Do the sailors in a frenzy, in a trance, sometimes aim their ships at rocks? Do our harmonies haunt and vise the mind, pressing out all sense? Do the men sometimes leap from their boats and try to swim where our voices are? Oh, sister, yes, they do. Is it our fault or our intention? Oh, sister, it is not. We sing a song of consequence. We sing a song of cost. They know it so, and they call us monsters. Sing. Let the sound fly from your mouth. Let it land light and dark. We three bird girls will sing out with you. We'll join our voices in the chorus, and the sound will rise like bells, like wind, like strings, like prayer. The song that's yours to sing. Louder, louder. You'll see. And if the song doesn't land and light the dark, sister, keep singing. Your song, holy, consequential, true." So basically what I took from that is to keep singing, keep denouncing.
What's the name of the author in the book one more time? And maybe the other book also that you quoted quite a bit.
Okay. The book is Wake Siren. And the author is Nina McLaughlin.
And the other book you were quoting?
The other is not a book. It's an article written in 1996 in Harper's Magazine, and it's by Chuck Bowden.
Lots of external reading for you folks, for you Podspotters this week. Thank you both for being here. Thank you for doing this.
Thank you.
I'm going to end with a piece of audio that I would like to induct into the Podcast Hall of Fame from Sandra Rodriguez, the journalist of Juarez, who you mentioned quite a bit on the show. It's just her explaining the sort of damming up of humans in Juarez.
"I was looking at the border from very high. You can see the line, the border, and then a lot of lights. In my view, it was like the whole pressure of the whole rest of the continent trying to reach America and then getting stopped right at the border, which is Juarez. And I thought, this city cannot contain this much poverty or violence. I mean, all Latin America is coming. For some reason, that broke my heart. Like, this city cannot hold this, and it's going to explode. No city in the world can hold the whole pressure. This pressure turned into violence. This pressure turned into illegal business. This pressure turns into very bad conditions of living for the people. I just felt that I start to cry and cry."
We are here to look for the wonderful content that you don't yet know about. If you like this show, please check us out. Subscribe, visit thepodspotter.com, and on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, at thepodspotter for lots of good stuff. Please leave a review. That really helps. Subscribe, rate, judge us on Apple Podcasts, and help spread the word. We release every Monday with a review of a wonderful new pod, and we are just going to keep on trucking here, whether you like it or not. If you have questions, suggestions, or any other comments, please drop us a line on any of our social media platforms or at thepodspotter.com. This has been Zach Robidas. The Podspotter is created by the Price Brothers, produced by Oink Inc. Radio, associate producer Tori Adams, and is recorded and produced at Baker Sound in Philadelphia.